Okay, so now we're going to focus on abstract and specific aims. And the reason why we really focus on this, beyond just the fact that this is a widely read section of your grant, is that it's really the appropriate starting point for a grant is to get your abstract and specific aims on paper. And Megan gave us a really nice example of why that's important, where she was able to share those sections with a colleague, and through that discussion with that colleague, she realized that she had the abstract and specific aims for Grant 2, and she needed to do something else for Grant 1. And so it was good that she found that out after only writing a page and a half, then after writing a 6-page application and be on the verge of submitting it, and then realize, oh, it's the wrong grant. So that's why you really want to start early on these sections and send them around and have other people give you feedback so that you know you're on the right track with your ideas and the way that you're pitching those ideas to your audience. Okay, so just to go now to the slides. The abstract and specific aims create a first impression of your grant. As we've already heard from the other presenters, these are widely read sections. They're the only two sections that are distributed to the reviewers. FSROs do get their reviewers in that way. Some SROs just assign reviewers without input from the reviewers, but others will send around portions of the grant, usually the abstract and specific aims, to have the potential reviewers look at it and give feedback on whether or not they'd be able to review that grant and to what level they would be a match for that grant. And others have also already noted that many of the folks on the panel are going to read those sections just to get a sense of what your grant is about. So it's important that these be strong. And one other group that's not listed on the slide but we'll be talking about on the last day, Council, which is the group that actually makes the funding decisions, all they see of your grant is the abstract. So just remember that. The person who's going to decide if you're getting funded or not only sees the abstract. So this is really important that that be strong. So in terms of the requirements, you see them here. They're pretty straightforward. Basically, the abstract is going to be essentially a paragraph, and your specific aims are going to be one page. We're going to start with the specific aims. And so this is the section of the instructions that talks about the specific aims. So this will be in the slides that you can look at exactly what's supposed to be in there. And we'll look in more detail here. So what's the goal for these specific aims? Well, you want them to excite the reviewer. Again, this is the first thing that they read. So you want them to think, oh, I want to read the rest of this. This looks really good, rather than, oh, my God, how am I going to get through the next 6 pages? Remember, they start out being your friend and want to support you, but you know that support only goes so far. You have to earn it the rest of the way through to the end of the application. So be sure that you earn it on those first couple pages. You also want to inspire confidence in you. So again, it creates a first impression of you. And the other thing it does is it sets the framework for the rest of your application. So from reading the aims, they should really have an idea of the themes or questions that are going to guide this particular project. So it really sets the overarching themes and goals that you're going to carry through the rest of the application. So as they move through the application, there really shouldn't be any big surprises after reading the aims. The rest of it should really just be fleshing out what they read in the aims. Here are some of the essential elements, and you might recognize some of these from the aims that Elena put up and deconstructed for us in her talk. But in general, you're going to want to provide an overarching goal. What are the problems or issues that are under study in this application, and most importantly, why are they important? The theory, rationale, or motivation, so the why of the application, why are we looking at this? The approach. Now, you might not be going into the approach in a lot of detail at this point, but it is a good idea to give some kind of orientation to what the approach is. Is it behavioral? Is it neuroscience? Is it genetic? What am I going to get myself into here? Specific questions and hypotheses. So we want to see specific goals that are going to be addressed by the particular study. So this is where we're getting into a little more detailed view of what the application is about. And we also want to know something about the significance and the innovation of the work. Here is a little checklist that basically gets at those points but asks it more in a question format. And this slide is actually in your folder so that you can refer to it when we break into groups and look at your own specific aims. So when you're looking at your specific aims and the aims of the other person who's in your group, this is what you'll want to look through to see, you know, did I accomplish these things in my aims or did this other person accomplish these things in her aims? So now we're going to look at an example, and I'm using an example from one of my grants because all of you are going to get yours reviewed in your group, so I didn't want to steal someone's opportunity to deconstruct their own aims. But here's what the aims look like. So it's one page, and you can see there's some formatting and some indents and some white space to, again, make it a little bit more pleasing to the eye. And now we'll look in sections. And I'm not going to read this to you. You'll have these slides later so you can look in detail. But what you should notice is that every sentence or maybe every couple pairs of sentence has a purpose. So when you look at your own aims, realize that these are very short sections. So you don't have a lot of time to build up to a point. You need to make a point and move on. So when you're looking at your aims, you want to be thinking about what is this sentence doing for me? How does this further my goal of being funded? What is this communicating to the reviewer? So if we look at this example, the sentence highlighted in yellow, this is basically a statement of the problem. So kids with specific language impairment have trouble learning words. The next section, the pink, talks about the impact or the importance of this problem. So that places them at risk for other kinds of problems like academic failure. Green is then the potential solution. And so now this is a little bit longer section, talks about interactive book reading and what that exactly is so that someone's a little bit oriented to that. And then the blue section goes into the long-term goal and the specific objectives of this proposal, which is basically to figure out how to use this treatment with this population. Okay? So every sentence there has some sort of purpose. There's nothing that's just hanging out there. Then we go into the aim itself. So the unhighlighted part, the white part, is just a succinct statement of the aim. And you might not be able to tell here, but there's a couple of words there that are bolded. It's important to already start building in the reviewer's mind, what is this aim about? So they need some language to be able to link to that aim. What is aim one about? In this case, aim one is about the exposures to the target word or the treatment intensity that's needed for this treatment. So you want people to already start thinking, okay, aim one is treatment intensity, and they're going to then follow that through the rest of your application. The yellow is then the general problem, so the current version of book reading won't work for this population. And then the pink is the more specific problem. We don't really know what will. And so then the green is the solution that's going to be pursued in this aim, and just a tiny bit about the approach. So basically it's let's figure it out, and we're going to use a particular clinical trial strategy to do that. The other aims are set up in a similar way. Aim 2 is pretty similar to Aim 1, so there's not as much detail there, mostly just setting out about how it's different and what's going to be learned through this particular aim. And then Aim 3, again, we start with a succinct statement of the problem. Now here, the yellow part, there's not really a problem. It's more of an issue here that we can achieve the same number of exposures in different kinds of ways. So that's not necessarily a problem, but it's the issue that's going to be addressed. And then the pink is some theory and prediction about what way is going to be best. And then the goal or the outcome of this aim is what's shown in green there, that at the conclusion of this, we'll know the best way to do this. And then finally in the aims, there's this kind of concluding section, which is a summary of the aims. The yellow is a summary of the outcomes or the predicted accomplishments, and then the pink is the next step further. And then I have a note here that was a little bit boring. It sort of trailed off here. So probably I needed to reduce some things in the other portions of the aim and pump this up a little bit and incorporate a little bit more detail here about the impact or significance of the work to really kind of close off in a stronger way. Okay, so that's an example of the aims and an example of what you'll be doing in your mentor groups, although you can choose your own methods. But essentially, you want to go through your aim statement and deconstruct it this way and see what each sentence is doing for you and how it then accomplishes what's on the checklist and sort of setting up the important points. So now as we look at the abstract, once again, here are the instructions that'll be on the slides that you can refer back to exactly what you're told to do. As Elena said, you should follow the instructions, so they're there for you to help you with that. The goals of the abstract are pretty similar to the aims. You want to invite and encourage the reviewer to read the grant. You want to excite the reviewer about the research and inspire confidence in the PI. So you are going to notice a good bit of overlap between your aims and abstract, and that's okay. You want people to be building up this idea of what the grant is about, so that's fine that there is some overlap. The essential elements, again, you'll need an overarching goal. You'll want to say a little something about the approach just to orient people to where you're going and also to make sure that you get people with appropriate expertise as reviewers. And you want to be highlighting the significance and the innovation. Here's another checklist. This one's also in your packet that you can use to evaluate your own abstract. And then here's an example from the same grant. So once again, here's what it looks like. It's about half a page. And now here, since it's half a page, you don't have any room to put in more spacing or creative things. And then once again, we can deconstruct it. And again, I won't read it to you, but it's kind of color-coded here what the main points are. So once again, you'll see a lot of similarity with the aims that I just showed you. So the yellow part, which is at the very beginning, is the general problem. Kids with SLI have trouble learning new words. You might remember that from the aims. The pink is the more specific problem that's going to be addressed. So there's few effective treatments or proven treatments. The green, then, is the long-term goal to adapt a known treatment for use with this population. The blue is the current step towards the long-term goal, which is a preliminary clinical trial. And again, part of that gets into the methodology to get the right reviewers who are familiar with clinical research and the methodology involved in that. The aims, then, are given in brief. And so you'll see each aim is shown in this abstract, and it's the color coding there, where aim one is the peach, and then the next color, bluish purplish, that's aim two, and then the gray moves into aim three. So all of the aims are included in the abstract, at least to some degree. And once again, you're trying to establish some basic terminology that people can link to your aims. So the peach aim is about adequate intensity, the purple is about the extent of benefit, and the gray is about the best combination. And then finally, the orange section goes around to the outcomes and impact. And I thought this was better than what I had in my specific aims. And you can see it's a bigger section here, so I spent more time developing that. That would have been good to incorporate in my specific aims, that level of detail in those particular points. Okay, so that's it for the abstract. So just some general tips. Many people write these two sections as an afterthought, and as we've talked about, that's terrible. This is really where you want to start because it sets the whole framing for your grant, and if it's going in a bad direction, you need to know now. So start here and share these with mentors immediately. Get some feedback. Talk through why you're putting things the way you're putting it, what the major significance and impact is. Make sure you've got a good message at this point before you move forward writing the entire grant. Both sections should be concise, as you saw, half to one page, depending on which one we're looking at. That means that you really need to get out anything that's unnecessary. So make sure that you are trying to use straightforward terminology so that you don't have to define terms in your abstract and aims, or that you can maybe put some very concise reference points for those terms. You don't have time to really build up information. You need to just kind of state the facts and get the major points out there. Make sure that you have new information in each statement. You also don't have room to be repetitive here or reiterate. They're short sections, so people should be able to follow along with what you're saying and not need a lot of repetition in these sections. And the final thing is that both sections need to use powerful and compelling language. So what someone has pointed out before, just saying that there will be clinical implications of the work, that's not powerful. That's very vague. It's not compelling at all. So really think about how you're saying the impact that's there and try to put it in words that are going to be really compelling to others and very exciting to others. This is really your first sales pitch. And if you get this sales pitch right at this early section before you write the rest of the grant, you'll know the kinds of pieces that you want to really play up in the other sections of the grant. You need to write for a semi-naive audience, so you want to avoid jargon or provide short and clear definitions of crucial terms. If you do need to have technical terms, pick a single term and stick with it. Remember that everyone who reviews your grant is not going to be expert in your area, and particularly when counsel is looking at these, counsel is a broad group of people, including folks from the community as well as scientists. So you really don't want to be miring them in jargon when they're going to try and decide whether to defend your research or not. You want to make it compelling to a regular person who isn't immersed in your area of acronyms. Ask others to review these two sections extracted from your grant, and this will give you a sense of how reviewers might react to it. So if your internal reviewers are not excited about these sections, you need to keep working. And maybe you don't need to revise the grant totally. Maybe you need to revise more your sales pitch for the grant or the way that you're explaining things, the impact that you're trying to sell, to get the right message that people are going to find to be compelling.